More than 1,500 people turned out at St. Martin's Episcopal Church in Houston to pay their respects to former First Lady Barbara Bush yesterday. Four of the five former presidents attended, along with First Lady Melania Trump. But for a woman who was the wife of one president and the mother of another, the funeral was very much a family affair, as Mrs. Bush's five children, 17 grandchildren, and seven great-grandchildren played prominent roles in the service. Granddaughters gave tribute.
Many women have done excellently, but you surpass them all.
Grandsons acted as pallbearers, and second son, Jeb Bush, delivered the eulogy.
Mom got us through our difficult times with consistent, take it to the bank, unconditional, but tough love. She called her style a benevolent dictatorship, but honestly, it wasn't always benevolent. We learned to strive to be genuine and authentic by the best role model in the world. Her authentic plastic pearls, her not culling her hair. By the way, she was beautiful till the day she died.
Barbara Bush died Tuesday at the age of 92. She and President George H.W. Bush were married for 73 years. For more on former First Lady Barbara Bush and a broader look at the presidency, we knew who to call. John Dickerson is now the co-anchor of CBS This Morning and the author of this month's cover story in The Atlantic magazine, How the Presidency Became Impossible. Good to have you back on a very familiar set, John.
Thank you very much. I admire watching you, Margaret, so it's great to be on.
Oh, thank you. George and Barbara Bush, they had the longest marriage in presidential history.
Yeah, and that's what I think about when I think about Barbara Bush. They say about the spouses of people who serve in the military, they are the backbone of the military. And that emotional relationship for 73 years, she was the backbone to the family dedicated to public service. It started, as you say, 73 years ago. Her fiancé went off to war. They wrote constant letters to each other, and then for a month they just stopped. She didn't know what happened. Then he was shot down. For 3 days, she didn't know whether he lived or died. That's the beginning of an emotional roller coaster of being connected to someone who's dedicated their life to their country. And she had to go through all of that. And then watching him get abused in public and knowing how painful that is and not being able to do anything about it. Anybody who's a spouse who watches their spouse get abused in public and can't do anything knows what that pain is like. Now, and multiply that by three, because she had two sons in politics too. That dedication throughout her whole life to that public service, that is where dedication to family becomes dedication to country.
Was it right for President Trump not to attend the funeral?
Well, I think, I don't know right or wrong. We certainly know that he attacked the Bush family during the campaign, said that George W. Bush lied the country into the Iraq War, attacked them both specifically and a lot of the things they stood up for. So I think Melania Trump was in keeping with the continuity of a long presidency. But I think you could have gotten into something maybe a little bit more bitter if he had attended. So you don't want to do anything to take away from that extraordinary life and the celebration of it. So I think it worked out well.
This was an extraordinary read in The Atlantic, your piece. You've been working on it for quite some time. You write, Americans need their president to succeed, but the presidency has set him up for failure. What do you mean?
Well, so let's make a general point. What's happened to the presidency is it's gotten out of shape. So people may think we're about to talk about this specific president, but let's go back to President Polk. The 11th president, Sarah Polk, his wife, had them play Hail to the Chief when he walked in the room because they were worried people wouldn't recognize him and know who he was.
I love that anecdote.
Now we have a presidency who's basically the most famous person on the globe, on the planet. So that is not the way the framers intended it. And instead of not noticing the president, we are whipsawed by the president's behavior in anything he does or anything we notice. And you notice I'm making a distinction between the president and the presidency. If you think of the presidency, it's an enormous ship. There is a captain of that ship, and we spend a lot of time talking about him, or someday, one day, her, and it is fitting and proper that we do so. But the ship itself has taken on barnacles. Some people want the ship to act like a kayak, some people want it to act like a barge. And all of those expectations we have about the ship of the presidency reflect on our aspirations for the country and the way we think about the captain of that ship.
And when did that departure happen, that evolution of the presidency?
It depends on where you want to put down the needle on the record. You can think in terms of national security. After 9/11, something changed. It was no longer about big, slow-moving armies. It was about threats that could come through the mail, that could come through email, that could disrupt the country by a few people plotting together to use planes to fly into a building. That changed what a president had to keep his eye on. George W. Bush, after that attack, in his briefings in the morning with the presidential daily brief, he went through threat by threat by threat. Well, if you do that, your whole day is taken up by threats. That focus on the national security piece is one piece. The rise of primaries and television has turned the presidency into a kind of performance show that was not the founders' intent. The founders didn't want presidents to even run for the office for fear that grubbing for votes would get in the way of clear reason to adjudicate the issues of the day. Well, now we have a reality show president. We see how that has changed. Those are just, and then of course the rise of partisanship. Some people are even going to look at raising this question and say, well, this is an attack on Trump, or this is an effort to make excuses for him. We can't see any question, no matter how much we try to step back, outside of that partisan lens, and that partisanship has hurt the presidency and it's hurt Congress.
Well, one of the frustrations with the presidency and some of what you've talked about came up in this past election, and the solution being offered was, let's look to the private sector, that a businessman, a CEO, could really take charge. But you puncture that idea.
Well, that's right, because they're not the same job. And, you know, and Michael Bloomberg, in that excellent interview you had with him, explained the differences in the job. There are a certain set of attributes for the presidency. One of them is recognizing that you don't know everything you don't know. And that's what Michael Bloomberg is talking about. A lot of people who've been successful in business have been successful and are sometimes blind to what they don't know. And so there's Gautam Mukunda at Harvard has done a careful study of this. And the way CEOs are elevated through a company, there's a filtering process. Through the presidency, that same filtering process doesn't exist for the job we're electing people to actually go to. And so the idea that a business person can come in is just, it's not consistent with the actual job they have to perform.
And there's no easy solution.
There's no easy solution. And we don't, in the press and in the public, allow presidents to do things. We don't allow them to make mistakes. We don't allow them to change their mind, all of which are part of best practices in any other large organization. So there aren't even easy solutions. And we don't provide a road to those solutions in the way we both cover the presidency and in the way, as partisans, we react to the behavior of individual presidents.
It's a great read, John. Thank you. So good to have you
back here. Take care.
We'll be back in a moment.